Alrighty, hello everybody and welcome back. Tonight I look like a professional gaming streamer because apparently I couldn't figure out how to get my microphone to work. So that's fun. It's never a boring day. But we find a way. We always find a way. Take one day at a time. Anyways, tonight we're gonna follow up a little bit from our last lecture, and the last lecture was a lot about where do flavors and aromas come from in wine? So, we talked about how, flavors and aromas come from the grape itself. We talked about the impact of the vineyard. I'll just go back so we can just revisit this a little bit. How every variety is different and unique from each other, but there's a baseline of flavors and aromas in the wine. We talked about the activity of microorganisms and how they kind of manipulate and shape the flavors and aromas that are in the wine. Processing choices as well make a big change or big difference as well. So like during the fermentation, the ratio of juice to skins, lees contact, whether or not you filter your wine, etc. And we also talked about aging as well. Aging is very important. So for, aging decisions, this is very baseline for the how long you age it, the temperature during aging, the type of oak you use, the pH of the wine, oxygen exposure, sanitation practices. This is all very important. So today I really want to dive deeper into the aging aspect and talk about tertiary aromas. So if you remember from our last lecture when we would talk about like the grape itself, that was a primary flavor. That's where primary flavors come from. So that's like cherry, dried fig, all of the fruity flavors. Sometimes for certain varieties, cedar, tobacco, dill, that's typical of Tempranillo, but it's different for other grapes. Those are typical flavors that come from the grape itself. Secondary came from processing decisions. So that's like the yeast that's involved, the flavors and aromas that the yeast itself brings out. So that's kind of, sets the baseline for you guys. And then tertiary flavors and aromas are formed during aging. So for me, that means in a barrel, but for a lot of the sommeliers out there, sommeliers and other professionals, it means aging in a bottle. So we're gonna dive into that. So wine barrels, aging, and tertiary aromas. Let's dive in. So this lecture is gonna talk about the impact that wine barrels have on the wine itself. We're going to talk about the history of wine barrels, wine barrel anatomy, breakdown of how the oak helps the wine, actually, and then we're going to talk about what happens to wine exactly as it ages, like in the barrel and also in the bottle. That's where the tertiary aromas really start to develop. And also a little interesting tidbit on what actually determines the ageability of wines. Like what characteristics does a wine have that determine, exactly how long it can age in the bottle before it loses its potency, before it starts to go south and not be in its prime anymore. So we'll talk about that as well. So history of wine barrels, very fun. Barrels were actually used for transport and storage, not so much as actually having an impact, a positive impact on the flavor and aromas of wine. They're just very practical purpose. They just happen to bring a lot of other positive characteristics as well. And before wines were actually able to be purchased by the bottle, they were purchased by the barrel. So it was very practical in that sense as well. The first evidence we have of barrels is from Mesopotamia, and it was palm tree wood originally. And we don't know exactly if that was the first barrel because barrels are typically made out of wood and wood disintegrates over time. So it's not like clay or other things that, hold well over centuries that you can find in archaeological digs. Typically, barrels will rot and decay and there's nothing left. So it's hard to know exactly, but that's what we know as of now. Amphorae were much more prevalent in archaeological findings, of course, because they do not decay like wood. So those are typically made out of, like a clay or ceramic kind of deal. So that's originally the purpose of amphorae as well. Over time, as people started tasting and drinking wine from barrels, they had noticed that it really had a lot of positive characteristics added to the wine, and they really enjoyed it. So they kept using it, and they started making barrels out of different oaks and taking notes of, hey, this worked really well. This one worked well for this wine, and it kind of started to build and grow from there. So lots of wonderful things came from that. So oak, why oak? Why don't we use cedar or palm tree anymore, or any other type of oak or any type of other tree out there, excuse me, any type of wood? Oak is, if you ever stacked wood in the yard like me as a child, doing a lot of stacking wood, we had natural burning wood stoves in the house, would warm the house. We would have oak and we would have cedar. And if you've ever stacked wood before, you notice that oak is really heavy. Like, you can only carry a few pieces of wood as oak as a small child compared to cedar. Cedar is much lighter weight. Oak will burn a lot hotter than cedar, so if you're going to bed for the night, you put on a couple nice, really hefty pieces of oak wood, and it'll warm the house for the night. So that relates a lot to why oak is so important to wine. It's a very fine grain. It's really thick. It's really heavy. It seals very well. It doesn't rot easily because it's so dense and so tight when it's in contact with moisture. It will flex nicely when heat is applied. It does not allow the texture is because it's so dense and thick. It doesn't allow for liquid to leak, but because it is porous, all wood is porous, it does allow a little bit of oxygen to pass through, and that is favorable, as we'll talk about in a couple of slides here. So, in addition, oak also adds, of course, flavors. It adds tannins and texture to the wine. So tannin and texture are very synonymous sometimes with the wine. We're going to talk about that in just a second. Also, oak can be reused and repurposed for many years. It's very sturdy, so it becomes very economic for a lot of financial reasons. So there's just a lot of reasons to really enjoy oak barrels still to this day. I mean, there's a reason that we still use it after centuries and centuries of making wine. So yeah, it's always wonderful, and it can be reused and repurposed. People like making furniture out of it. People do all sorts of stuff with it, so it's good. So overall, barrels. We kind of talk about barrels. We have a little bit of anatomy with the barrels. There's different toasting levels for each type. So there's, imagine, this is kind of has to do with the level of char on the inside of the barrel. So for every different type, there's different species of oak tree. There's French, American, Hungarian, etc. For each one of those, when they're created, they can have different levels of toast inside of them. So it becomes very complex about the different flavors and aromas that come from each toast. And there are some that are very practical for certain types of wine and some that are not so practical, but it gives you a lot of creative freedom in what flavors and aromas you want to impact on the wine. So there's different types, but there's also, as we've advanced through time, there's other alternatives too. Some people are using cherry wood, walnut, and chestnut as well for their wines. They haven't really broken ground. They haven't really become extremely popular. Oak is still reigning superior as far as the type of wood that we use. But overall, it does really well because it gives more tannins, which helps with the lifespan and the mouthfeel of the wine. Vanilla flavors, like tea flavors, and also tobacco-like characteristics. So those are all very subtle flavors and aromas that help the wine. As far as the anatomy goes, when we talk about an oak barrel, this part up here, this flat, is called the head. It's typically where a logo is burned into the wood or carved in. That's really important. That's where a lot of leaks happen. So everyone's talking about the head of the barrel. These hoops or chimes are typically screwed into place, and this helps to keep a tight seal. There's also a personal favorite, which is called the bung hole. Yes, that is actually what it's called. You can laugh, it's okay. And the bung itself, which is typically a silicone piece that you put in just to seal it tight. So overall, I mean, there's lots of other anatomy here, but the head, And the hoops and the bung are typically the ones we use, the words we use the most. So let's break it down. How does oak help wine? Like, what are all the wonderful things that it does besides transport and being able to buy wine by the barrel? That'd be cool. That'd be nice if people started doing that again. Number one, it helps with evaporation and oxygenation. So I know when we talk about oxygen getting into wine, typically we talk about it on an extreme front, with it spoiling wine. And that's not the case. This is a micro oxygenation, is a very small transfer of oxygen over time. And that helps to soften the tannins specifically. That's what the oxygenation does. Evaporation will help concentrate flavors and aromas. So wine does evaporate over time. The barrels will get lower and lower, and we'll have to go through every couple of months and actually refill the barrels so that way it doesn't have too much headspace, because that's when you have too much oxygen in there, and that's when you actually start to spoil. So the evaporation that takes place from the barrel, that's what we call the angel's share. It's a very common term in the industry. It's the angel's share of wine. But it helps to concentrate flavors and aromas. Number two, it imparts new flavors and aromas. So we have a compound called phenols, and those are just, organic compounds that have to do a lot with mouthfeel and flavor and also color in the wine. So with this part, we're talking about flavor. So phenols in the wood produce vanilla or other flavors and aromas depending on the oak and the toast. And I have a little graph, little chart for you guys to see exactly which oak and what toast gives what flavors and aromas. And number three, it imparts tannins, specifically elagitannins. And these come from the lignin structures of the wood and protect wine from severe oxidation and reduction. So we're going to talk about what determines the ageability of a wine, and tannins are one of the things that helps it over time to preserve. So that's extremely important because, if you have a wine that has a good shelf life, it means you have a longer time to sell it. It could be deemed higher quality. It could be worth more money, essentially. So, ageability is always a good thing. So, number one, evaporation, oxygenation. Like we said, over time, wine evaporates from the pores of the barrels, concentrating the flavors and intensity of the wine. So, the longer a wine ages, typically the more intense the flavors get, and also the more complex as well. So, for Then this is also where we're talking about like tertiary flavors and aromas developing. So flavors and aromas that are typical from evaporation and oxygenation, especially in bottle aging. So we find over time you get a lot of hazelnut, almond, walnut, and peanut flavors. It's very nutty. You get nutty flavors and characteristics in the wine. As far as imparting new flavors and aromas, this comes from the wood itself. That's when you'll get more of like cinnamon, allspice, vanilla, and clove. So I like to think of oak sometimes almost as like baking spices, as far as the flavors that come from it. So you can kind of think about that. American oak is very synonymous with vanilla. Whenever you smell vanilla in a wine, you can almost guarantee that it's an American oak. That's kind of a dead giveaway. But, So that's another tertiary compound that's flavor. That's where it comes from, is the oak itself. Those flavors will start to become more prevalent as it ages in the oak and as it ages in the bottle as well. So a lot of things kind of impact what flavors you get. Obviously, the type of wood you use, like I said, French oak, American oak, Hungarian oak, they're all going to have different components. The toast of the wood, was it light toast, medium toast, heavy toast, and also where the oak was grown. So, interestingly enough, just like Pinot Grigio coming from Monterey versus a Pinot Grigio coming from El Dorado County is going to have different characteristics because it's grown in two different climates. Oak that's harvested from two different climates is also going to provide different characteristics as well. And no one really talks about that. It's also very interesting as well. So overall, for the climate difference, if there's a cooler climate, it'll have a finer grain and less oxygen contact, which would mean a more subtle oak influence on the wine. So a hotter climate would mean a larger grain, more oxygen contact because you have it's more porous and much more intense oak influence on the wine. So it really just depends what you're going for. So this is the chart I was talking to you guys about. It outlines three very popular different types of oak that we use in the winemaking industry, and also what correlates for like light toast, medium toast, heavy toast comes from it. So for American oak, of course, we have vanilla across the board. You know, vanilla, dill, coconut for a light toast. Medium toast involves honey, caramel, roasted coffee, and cocoa. A heavy toast would be caramelized sugar, espresso, tiramisu, and wood smoke. So you can kind of see it's just like cooking, right? If you literally caramelize something, the lighter the caramel is going to be, you know, lighter flavors, and the heavier you go, it gets almost like a burnt, much more intense flavors. For French oak, we get, you know, nutmeg, clove, allspice, so baking spices here. Then for medium toast, we get more baking spice, but kind of cedar, cigar box, maybe some chocolatey components. And then for heavy toast, we get, you know, some Asian spices, cardamom, ginger, clove, creme brulee, cedar, charcoal, even, it depends. Hungarian oak is kind of a lesser known oak that we use oftentimes in the wine industry as well. That also has some vanilla, sweet spice flavors. Then moving into the medium toast, you get more of banana, sarsaparilla, sweet spice, heavy toast, you know, butterscotch, toffee, and molasses. So overall, it seems like American does have some sweetness with the vanilla, but Hungarian also has quite a bit of sweetness associated with it as well, whereas French oak is more of kind of like spices and kind of like that mustiness that can come from it. So a little bit more on American versus French oak. American oak typically has a wider grain, which allows for more oxidation in the wine, so much more of that transfer. So it's going to help age the oak faster. And that's because it has a wider grain because the oak itself grows faster, and it will result in giving lower tannins because of that wider grain. But it gives much more lactones like vanilla, caramel, and baking spices. And typically, this is used to age wines that already have high tannins to help smooth it out. That was kind of a footnote in the article that I was reading. I think that could be debated, but that's just information if you would like it. For French oak, we typically have a much finer grain, so less transfer for oxygenation, micro oxygenation in the barrel. This is because the tree grows slower. This will give it much more tannins. And also, this will help result in the flavors of cedar, cigar box, dark chocolate, nutmeg, allspice, typically. So, moving on, number three, imparting tannins. So, tannins, what are tannins? So, if you ever go out into a vineyard, or if you're at home, it's easier when you're actually tasting grapes used for winemaking, but if you needed to at home, you could just taste a regular grape. If you put a grape in your mouth and you chew on it, and you know, if you're eating the grape, and then take a second to really focus on chewing on just the skin, like just the skin of the grape that's like left behind, and you'll get this drying sensation in your mouth. Like it feels like something is literally sucking all the saliva out of your mouth and it's dry. That is tannin. That's exactly what tannin comes from. It comes from the skins and it comes from the seeds of the grape. So these are phenolic compounds. They help impart tannins. You know, they also help give the wine mouthfeel and texture. So it helps preservation, texture, and they're also related to color compounds as well. So I know it's very complex. This is actually right here what you see. This is an example of one tannin polymer. Like this is tannin. And then right here we have this is a phenolic compound. So they all, it's a very intense chemistry. I don't need to get into it for this class, but it is very complex. So for adding texture to the wine, mostly comes from the tannins, like we said. They also provide astringency, contributing to the wine texture and mouthfeel. The science behind that drying mouthfeel is that the proteins in your mouth will bind with the tannins from your saliva, making it feel dry. That's what happens there. Ideally, for a wine to have nice tannins, it should provide a full or round texture. It's kind of just like fill your mouth, but would should not create any like angular or donut textures in your mouth. So interpret that as you will. It just takes a lot of experience tasting to know what you like or what you don't like as far as like tannins, how that goes. So wine aging decisions and styles, this is more of the where tertiary aromas come from. So for this, we have surly aging. So this is, you know, leaving wine on the lees. So this is inactive yeast, bacteria, cells left over from fermentation. So this will give your wine a very creamy taste, a better mouthfeel, and also kind of a yeasty aroma. And that, like, aromas and flavors that come from that will be more kind of nutty, toffee, creme, or like creme brulee or cream caramel, and sourdough. So when we talk about yeasty, that's not like a gross yeasty. That's like a fresh baked bread yeasty. It's very good. It's very pleasant. So that's where that comes from. And that is a tertiary aroma. There's also some tertiary aromas involved in a very specific style of wine called Madeira or Madeirizing, and that is directly exposing the wine to heat and oxidizing it to produce caramel and other flavors in the wine. So it will not make you sick. It is a very interesting historical wine, and I believe we talk more about it right here. Yep. Okay, perfect. So Madeira dates back from the age of exploration, so the end of the 15th century. So it was standard in shipments heading to the New World or the West Indies. So for this wine, it was fortified to prevent it from spoiling on the ship. So it was deliberately, you know, flooded with a bunch of super high proof alcohol, because anything above 16%, basically any type of microbial spoilage growth will have a really hard time proliferating. It's gonna die. So that's the theory behind the alcohol. You're just like you see in movies, like someone gets cut or stabbed. They take a bottle of whiskey or a bottle of vodka and just drench it, because it's how you sterilize a lot of things. It doesn't feel good. Wouldn't recommend it, but that's the theory behind that. That's why you see that. So yeah, they fortified this wine in this travel, and but they did not know that the wine was being exposed to very excessive heat and movement on the ships. So it actually ended up transforming the flavors of the wine. And the only reason that they discovered what was happening was because an unsold shipment came back to them, and they tasted it, and they were like, "What the heck? This isn't what we were sending out." And for whatever reason, people are still buying this. Like, they like this. This is a total accident. So, you know, they kept doing it. I mean, obviously, people still enjoyed it. A lot of people use it for cooking. It's a very good cooking wine. Lots of good flavors and aromas, and you can buy some that already have salt and pepper in them to help you with your cooking. It's also available in all styles now as well. So it's dry wines, sweet wines, aperitifs. That's like a after dinner little sipper to help, you know, kind of settle your stomach or send you off before bed. So that's pretty interesting. But because of the composition, because it's already been cooked, it's already been oxidized on purpose. It's already been fortified. It can last for decades. It's just, even after being opened, it's just like everything that could have possibly happened to it has already happened to it. It's, you know, in a sense, damaged beyond as much as it could be. So there's nothing else that could happen to it at that point. So, and it's enjoyable. It still makes for good wine. So, some fun information there. So moving on, I just have a little side note here about barrel care and maintenance. Barrels do dry out, so they do hold a seal. They do keep moisture in, but typically they're meant to have wine in them at all times, you know, for the most part. So if there's an extended period of time where there's nothing in the barrel, it will dry out, and the staves, like you see here, each individual piece of oak here will actually start to separate, and it will lose that seal. So oftentimes, if a barrel is left empty for a period of time, we'll have to test the seal and fill it with water first, because we'd rather lose water than wine. It's, You know, water is much less expensive of a loss, although it's not that great for the environment, unfortunately. There are other methods too, like some people will keep a humidifier in their cellar and it will keep it so humid that it will prevent too much evaporation from the barrels of the wine and also keep any empty barrels more hydrated so that way they don't dry up quite that bad. But you can see the water literally seeping through the cracks here, and that would be wine if you know if you weren't careful with that. There's also a lot of other like pests that create issues. Those are like boar beetles, and those will eat holes through the wood, and you'll have to patch those up with like some barbecue skewers or something. But overall, there's a lot of care and maintenance. You shouldn't leave your barrels outside because of these little rascals, because of the bugs, and you should always keep them hydrated. So don't store just water in your barrels because mold and mildew will grow. Make sure that you sulfur wick them appropriately to keep any microorganisms from growing. Keep it sterile in there, well, as much as possible. So wood is not sterile because it's porous. So let's get that out of the way right now. Once it's infected with something that's growing in there, it's over. Like you have to sell it. There's no way that you can completely. It's very difficult to completely sanitize it after that point. You have to be very careful with that. So moving on to bottle aging for wine, like we talked about tertiary aromas during the aging process and what comes from each of those. So those, while the bottle's aging, those just kind of develop more over time, become more complex. So ultimately, for bottle aging in wine, you see lots of changes in color, flavors, and textures. But a little disclaimer, not all wines are meant to be aged. Some are meant to be just drank right now, and that's okay too. It doesn't mean that the wine is necessarily bad quality. It's just has to, it pertains to that style of wine. So we'll talk about what happens during aging, and then we'll also talk about ageability, what makes a wine ageable, basically, and how do you know how long it's going to be good for. So first thing is there is a change of color in bottle aging. Color stability, so the color of the wine becomes more stable with tannin and oxygen integration from barrels. So that's one of the beauties of aging it in the barrel. You want to get the color stable so you know exactly what it's going to mostly stay at over time. But in a bottled wine, as it ages, the younger a wine is, the more purple it is. The more, it's so much more vibrant. It's almost, you know, it's almost gem-like. So that's very typical of a red wine for youth. Over time, it'll actually start to lose that purple, and it will start to become more like a brick red, as you can kind of see right here. So it goes from purple, this almost looks black in the picture, but the purple starts to fade, and then it's red, and the red starts to fade, and then it can get orange or even brown over time. For a white wine, it should be the most clear, the most white at a young age. Then over time, it'll start to turn much more yellow and gold, and then finally brown when it oxidizes completely. So it's not uncommon to see a wine that has aged, that's sweet, to be very yellow when you drink it. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's just that's what happens over time as it involves with oxygen. So overall, for what changes, that's what change happens in color. The changes that happen in flavors and aromas is typically as a wine ages in bottle, it'll start to diminish the primary aromas. So that is the fruitiness that came from the grape. So you'll get much less of that, you know, jammy, you know, brighter fruits like strawberry, much less of like citrus, much less of that overall, less fruitiness. And you'll typically get other flavors more like developed, like mushroom and stone, and all the complexity of like the tertiary aromas we were talking about, like the creme brulee and the almond and the walnut, etc. So for some wines, you know, we don't really want to do this, or depending on the style you like, again. So for some wines, I like very fruity, like Sangiovese and Grenache. So that's not something I would necessarily recommend aging for that long. But like I said, it becomes a preference at that point. Really comes down to preference. Okay, changes in texture. So we talked about tannins a little bit. So as tannins come from the skins, they come from the seeds, they come from oak, right? Well, over time, you know, even though tannin helps a wine age, it's because tannin starts to diminish as a wine ages. They start to diminish over time. So they, like, descriptors like grippiness, chewy, silky, and polished are very common. Positive tannin descriptors. Sometimes a wine can taste green, astringent, or unripe tannin. Those are common negative descriptors for tannin texture in wine as well. So that changes. And then as the tannin starts to diminish, you know, that's when you see like smoother wines. Typically, that's why they say wines do better with age, is because tannins start to diminish, and they'll be a lot softer in general. So then that leads us to our next topic. What determines how a wine can age? You know, how do I know? It really comes down to four traits, and that is sugar content, alcohol, acid, and tannins as well. So for sugar, wines that are really sweet tend to age longer. So the way that I remember this is honey. Like, you can put a jar of honey out on the counter. You don't have to refrigerate it, and it's good. It's golden. It's good for, you know, months. It does not spoil. So the sugar content is so high that you know, nothing is going to spoil it at that point. So wines with 10 to 20% residual sugar will typically last fairly long. Sugar is a natural preservative, you know, et cetera, like we just said, why jams, preserves, and honey last a long time. Examples of sweet wines would be Sauternes, ports, Tokay, yeah, I think it's Tokay. German or Alsatian Rieslings will age anywhere between 15 to 50 years. So, definitely a big indicator. So if you see a Sauternes, that's, you know, that's sweet. And like I said, this yellow color develops over time. This has been aged. You can tell. So those will typically last very long. This is a nice little chart that I appreciate because sometimes I get confused on categories of sweetness for wines. So for like there's a little conversion here. So if you are expressing residual sugar in a percentage, it's typically in this range here, and I like this. But some people also express it in grams per liter, which is over here. So all you'd have to do is move the decimal over one place to see one versus the other. So for a dry white wine, it's typically 0.1 to 0.2%. For a dry red, 0.2 to 0.3. Off dry, anywhere between 1 and 3%. So it's literally 10 times more sweet than what you see up here, 0.1 to 1%. So it's an off dry wine. For a sweet wine, it's greater than 3%. For a port or sherry, it could be anywhere between 5 to 15%. And for dessert and ice wines, that is 10 to 20% residual sugar in the wine. So yeah, very sweet. Definitely more calories in these guys. But very good. Very good wines. Okay, alcohol. That's another way to determine ageability. So wines that typically have a high alcohol content will age very well. Like I said before, anything above 16% alcohol by volume is going to create a very nasty environment that microbes will not want to grow in. Like I said, you got to pour alcohol on the wound, sterilizes it, you know, like in the old Western films or whatever. Maybe you see John Wick or something, do that. If it helps you remember, great. But on the other side of that coin, there's also, and for like still wines, for regular like table reds, the lower the alcohol is also generally better. It's because alcohol is very volatile. So if you have a lower content, it's not going to be pushed out of the wine as much. It's not going to evaporate as quickly. So there's going to be less food for spoilage organisms to eat. Like there are organisms that consume alcohol and when it's in contact with oxygen, and they produce negative flavors and aromas. So you have lower alcohol for still wines, then you have the fortified wines, which are the much higher alcohol, 17 to 20% ABV. Those will age for a very long time. So examples of that would be ports, sherry, Madeira, and also vermouth as well. Just like, you know, if you've ever seen a bottle of vodka go bad in your cupboard, absolutely not. Like, alcohol is so high, nothing's happening to that. Okay, third, acid. So this really has to do with pH. So we talk about pH in wine. It's extremely so important. You think about acid and pH, you could think about, you know, a fish tank. So I don't know if any of you guys have fish, but if the pH shifts just slightly, there's a balance of good bacteria and bad bacteria in fish tanks, in our bodies, in other habitats, ponds, oceans, etc. The pH changes just slightly, everything freaks out. Like the things that are living, the positive things that are there living will start to die off because it's a bad environment for them, and like the negative bacteria will start to proliferate because it's a good environment for them. So we really don't want that. So that's why pH is so important. So it really determines the stability of the wine. We want all of the good microorganisms to flourish and do their thing to the wine, so we have a good product, and keep all of the negative spoilage organisms out of it. So pH helps with that, but it also helps determine the effectiveness of SO2 in the wine. And this isn't the winemaking class, so I wouldn't expect you to really dive into SO2 specifically, but all you need to know is it's a wine preservative. It keeps it from browning, and it keeps spoilage out at bay. So that determines the effectiveness of that. Also, acid slowly depletes over time in the wine. So it's another reason that it becomes softer, is because that depletes as well as tannins. So typically what you'd be shooting for a red wine, the pH is 3.6. So that's actually pretty acidic. That's kind of like a soda, like a can of Coca-Cola. And for a white wine, a pH would be 3.2 and below would be ideal. So that's very typical. If the pH was higher, if it was like 4.0 in a red, that's when you're going to see a lot of spoilage bacteria come into play and a lot of really funky flavors and aromas start to come into existence, which you don't want. So that's why that's important. So the lower the pH, the more acid there is in a wine, the more it will age, essentially. Okay, tannins. Tannins come from oak, berry skins, seeds, and stems. We talked about that. They also slowly dissipate over time in wine, but it smooths out the texture and they'll become less astringent. However, you do want some tannin in wine. It's not a bad thing. Tannins are actually very good for you. It's a very healthy thing to consume. It helps. It's been linked to helping us age longer ourselves. It's related to antioxidants. Resveratrol is another compound that helps with healthy heart and long lifespan as well. So you definitely want tannins in wine because they do help give texture, and also, like I said, they're healthy for you. So that's you do want to have a balance there. You do. Does white wine have tannin? Absolutely not, because it has had no skin contact. So you've pressed it, you've fermented the juice. So when you talk about a wine having tannin, if you're tasting a white wine and you're saying it has tannins, don't be that person, because it doesn't. So don't be like me. I got in trouble for saying that once. So learn from my mistakes. Here I have all of my resources if you'd like to see them. And if you're having a hard time opening up these links in the PDF that I download, just let me know and I'd be happy to fix that and share it with you. But anyways, that's what we got today for wine barrels, aging, and tertiary aromas. I hope that you learned something new. I hope it was enjoyable, and I'll be seeing you guys next time. All right, have a good week, guys. We'll see ya.